I think one of the most important takeaways from the conference had to do with the very process, and that was bringing together not the usual suspects, bringing together some people that had a close connection with the Catholic community, others that did not, some that worked in development, some in international development, some that worked in the banking industry, some that worked in government, all those people who would have real insight on this issue, to bring them together in a way that allowed for really honest, vigorous, it turned out, very spirited debate, and a kind of conversation that actually raised certainly good questions and even pointed us in the direction of some future research. The True Wealth of Nations is what we're calling a whole series of research projects having to do with economics and Catholic social teaching. The first of these projects actually grew out of an international conference we had here at the University of Southern California in June of 2008. Some of the papers from that conference were edited and just recently published by Oxford University Press. We're very proud of this volume. I love the cover on it. And it's True Wealth of Nations, Catholic Social Teaching and Economic Life, edited by Dan Finn, who worked on this next project as well. The basic idea here is that if the church is going to promote teachings about the economy, they should be subject to factual analysis and empirical verification. I don't know that there was anything that surprised me. One of the things that certainly encouraged me about the conference at the Vatican was the degree of interest, support, and openness demonstrated by the people there. There's an image afoot that the people in Rome just don't get it, or they don't listen, pretty much the way we talk about politicians and presidents of universities. And, you know, sometimes I'm sure it's valid, but my experience was, and particularly with the new cardinal from Ghana, Cardinal Peter Turkson, he's the real thing. I mean, the guy is sharp. He's quite at home in vigorous debate. He doesn't lecture. He listens. He comments. He laughs. And he showed a great interest in what we were doing. And he said quite publicly that this is the beginning of what he hopes will be a very, very fruitful collaboration between the Institute here at USC and the Vatican. One other thing that became very apparent in the papers that were submitted beforehand and came up then again at the conference itself and were commented on is that there is a tendency for people within the church, like myself, to talk to ourselves. And one of the things that can happen is when you do that, you tend to co-opt the ethical. What does that mean? Well, you tend to make an assumption that unless you're religious, you can't really be ethical. And then if you start talking like that, anybody who would be, let's say, an agnostic or an atheist, but who nonetheless would be very committed to the issues of development, very committed to the questions of justice, can feel like they're chopped liver, or somehow they've been ruled out of the possibility of making a genuine contribution to the common good. So I think one of the things that became clear is that if you're going to write a letter like the Pope did about the economy and address it to people, everyone of goodwill who would be interested in this subject, you can't then use insider language in such a way as to make it seem like people who would not be people of faith couldn't be part of the solution. And I think that became very clear in some of the papers submitted by people who are not part of the church and who at times felt a little bit marginalized by the language of the encyclical. It's a good lesson. There's a tendency in the modern world, Europe, but even more so I think in the United States, to privatize your religion. So what I believe or what I think is what I believe and what I think. I'm not going to impose it on anybody else. That wouldn't be appropriate. It would be against the Constitution. We have a separation of church and state. But then what happens is the separation of church and state, which I affirm, and religious freedom, which I believe in, becomes the separation of religion from society. In other words, one's religion doesn't have ramifications for the larger society. And I think if there's one thing that this Pope and previous popes and the last 100 years of papal teaching has tried to communicate again and again is that Catholicism is not to be privatized. It's to be shared, and it has some insights for the common good that doesn't require people who are not Catholic to become Catholic, but there are moral principles that anybody who wants a flourishing human life economically, as a family, in terms of work and so on, would benefit from. How to communicate that over against the pressure of the culture to keep it privatized is, I think, a real challenge. And it becomes especially a challenge when there are religious forces in society that want to impose, want to control, want to make sure who's in the White House and who's not. The task is not impose. The task is not control. The task is persuasion, rationality, common sense, and the common good.